we prepare ourselves to hear God's word, the last song we're going to do is Surely the Presence of the Lord is in this place. How many of you remember the theme words of ACFI? Suresh, what is it? What is the theme words? Hebrews 12:2. Right before that verse, it says, let us run the race marked before us with perseverance. You know, it doesn't say run the race with joy and happiness and goodness and all that. It's a run with perseverance, which means you and I, we will encounter struggles and trials and tribulations. And then right after that, it says, let us fix our eyes on Jesus. And so, you know, when you're running the race, one of the things that every coach will tell you is don't look back, right? Because you lose the momentum and you can lose the race too. And so as we are singing this last song, Surely the Presence of Lord, whatever baggage you have, let's put that aside and let's focus and worship him, because he said, don't look back, look unto me and I'll give you rest. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel his mighty power and his grace. I can feel the brush of angels' wings. I see glory in his face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel his mighty power and his grace. I can feel the brush of angels' wings. I see glory in his face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Let's bow down for prayer.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this wonderful day, O Lord. Thank you for bringing here to praise you, to worship you, to give you honor and glory for you alone, Lord. Thank you for all the good things you did in our life, O Lord. Yes, Lord, thank you for this time, Lord, to worship you, to praise you, Lord, and to hear your word, O Lord. Thank you for all the good things you did in our life, Lord. In Jesus' most precious name, we are asking all these things.
Amen. Please be seated.
Good evening and welcome to ACFI. Brother Josh is traveling, so I'm doing the announcements today. There's one announcement from Prem Milan. I'll let John do it, and then I have another announcement that I'll do later.
As you all know, Prem Milan is the first Saturday of every month. Once he's out.
I want to thank Vinod and Angel for spending all the time meeting the pastor and getting that sorted out. So just take note of that. Pray, and so next week, Saturday, we'll be meeting at Round Rock First Baptist. Okay, thank you. And I think the children dismissed for Sunday class. was trying to get my introduction, how to introduce the topic for today. I was just going through, and what I've written down some which I'll go through, but I want to just let you all know how God works in the midst of the believers when we meet. John Chirukuri was saying about the theme verse and how the verse before it talks about the perseverance or endurance. And my title is related to enduring. And so God leads, God works. Surely the God's presence and Holy Spirit's presence always in our midst. When we gather, two or three are gathered in His name, His presence is always there. And so I trust that, and I believe, and that's an encouragement for me to lead on into what I want to speak today. The portion that I've taken is from 1 Peter chapter 4, the last five or six verses, from verses 12 to 19. 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 12 to 19. It says like this. Beloved, do not think it strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened to you, but rejoice to the extent that you partake of Christ's suffering, that when His glory is revealed, you may also be glad with exceeding joy. If you are reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. On their part, He is blasphemed, but on your part, He is glorified. But let none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, an evildoer, or as a busybody in other people's matter. Yet, if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in this matter. Verse 17, for the time has come for judgment to begin at the house of God, and if it begins with us first, what will be the end of those who do not obey the gospel of God? Now, if the righteous one is scarcely saved, where will the ungodly and the sinner appear? Verse 19, therefore, let those who suffer according to the will of God commit their souls to Him in doing good as to a faithful Creator. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank You for this day. We thank You, O Lord, that we are able to come together as Your children to worship You, to sing praises unto You, and right now, Lord, to read Your word and to meditate upon Your word. Father God, Your word is living, Your word is truth, and Your word models our life. And Lord, as we look upon Your word tonight, I pray that You will just teach us from Your word and help us to quieten our hearts and our mind so that we can focus on Your word, because Your word is alive. And I pray, Lord, that You will just hide me behind the cross so that, Holy Spirit, You speak through me. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. It's interesting when Peter writes this, I was just amazed how Peter changed his life from how he was with Christ and then after Christ died and how he moves on. And here towards the end of his life, he's writing 1 Peter and 2 Peter. So 1 Peter was wrote earlier, I think it was written about 64 AD. And then 2 Peter was written about 66 or 67 AD. Now why he's writing that is, he sees the urgency that his life is going to end soon, because he's quite old at that time, and the church that he is ministering to is suffering, going through trials, going through problems, and he wants to, with urgency, teach them, tell them, so that it will be a challenge, it will be a strengthening for the church, that they can stand against what is coming on them. So he's writing so that we all can be strengthened today, because the word of God is alive. What he wrote many, many years ago, it's alive today. So what is relevant for us today is, I'm just taken of what is going on in the world and give you some statistics and see how it is applicable today. Verses 12, 19 that we are looking at talks about suffering and persecution and what the people at that time were going through. Today, there are some statistics I'm just reading out. There are more than 43 million Christians have been killed for their faith after Christ died. 43 million, roughly. And also it has been estimated in this century, more Christians are martyred than before. This century, meaning the century that we are in, 21st century. There have been more than 26 million documented cases. That means this is just recorded case that people have died in this century. There are undocumented cases in India, if you know, in other parts of the world. People have been just killed and thrown, nobody knows where. But just documented cases is 26 million people have died for Christ. And 200 million Christians in over 60 countries are facing persecution every day. Okay, you are reading it. We got emails even this week from India. And out of this 200 million Christians, more than 60% are said to be children who are suffering, going through this thing. And if you break it down, about 100 to 150,000 people are dying for Christ. Okay, that's the situation today. Christians, you and I are the most persecuted group in the world. Do you know that? We are the most persecuted group in this world. Okay? And there are so many things coming against us. Are we prepared? And thousands of people are being killed today. So persecution is not a strange thing for Christians. Only in Christian theology we learn about persecution. In other religious thing, you never hear about persecution. You hear about how to attain into karma and then going into the next life, or they themselves will be, if you do these things as jihadists, then you will get good life after you go to heaven. That kind of things is what they learn. But persecution, what you go through, the Christians, you never hear that in the other religions. We all go through. So the question then comes, why would God allow us, believers, who really love God and follow God, to suffer persecution? Right? Why would God allow us to go through this? And it's the Bible. Okay. And I think this is the point that I want to drive for this message that I have. I think God has been speaking to us and to me specifically, what is going on in this country especially. It is just coming in. And I think in the last Bible study I was mentioning about it, two things that just blew me away is how children are being used here to just take from Christian values to another religion, or they are teaching about other religion. In the Texas school board, I'm not sure how many of you all are following this, they're going to change the textbook, the history textbook actually. And there is a debate going on for several months. Only five people are fighting this. And five, whether they are congressmen or whatever, I don't know the details. But every time they meet, these five guys, probably they are conservative, they are fighting not to change the context of the history of the book, of the history, which now they are changing towards Islamization, the good things about Islam, and the history doesn't talk about that. That's what they're saying. So the majority of them are saying that is wrong. Islam is good. Islam is very good religion and things like that. Only five of them are fighting. They are going through persecution. They are going through the difficulty of standing against these people who are saying, no, it's good. And that's happening here in the Texas school board. They had a meeting last week in Dallas. It's still not resolved. You know, they say change that. And that is happening here today. So persecution is, it looks strange, but we are going to go through. We are going through. It may not be for you personally, for me personally, but it's happening. So we're going to just look at a few things from this seven verses and then close. But God gives hope. I don't want you all to think that there is no hope for us. There is always hope. And that's the beauty of Jesus Christ coming into the world, because he went through and he gave us that hope. That hope is there for us also. So do not be surprised if you are persecuted or have to go through this suffering. So don't get surprised. Okay, sometimes we say why, but we should not be surprised. And often that we believers, as I've said earlier, you know, we may just say, why is happening to me? Why is happening to our church? Why is happening to America? We can question like that. And why is it happening to the world? But it's going to happen. Okay. But there is a reason that it is going to go through that. Are we going to go through that? There is a reason. If you look back at history in the Word of God, Abraham went through that. What did Abraham go through? His son. He was told, take your son Isaac and go and do the sacrifice. Okay, that's amazing, that, right? If God tells us today, I want to sacrifice your son, can you take your son and go to this mountain and sacrifice him? And he did it. But that's happened in the early book that we have studied, the early part of the Bible, we have already looked at it. We also saw, I've read about Job. Okay, he was faithful to God, and everything was going very smoothly for him. Right? He was wealthy, he was prosperous, he had children, he had a lot of cattle and farm and everything. Everything was going very well for Job. But he also was a faithful man, but he went through persecution. He went through trials. He went through sufferings. Okay, you know what his friends told him? I'm sure you all know the story. He says, curse God and die. That's what they told him. But he was persistent. He was persevering. He endured the whole sufferings, and he became victorious. So it is there in the Bible. It's not only happening to us now, or it's going to happen to us or to our generations. It's there from the beginning. Okay, it's going to be there even today. So being a believer for us in this world, which is so much of corruption, corrupted world, the demands on Christians is even more than the world. The world cannot see it, but for us it's even more. And so we have to go through. And what are the things that we go through? Or what are the things that can be happening to us? Maybe our next door neighbor, he may be just giving you hell even today. Or your office. Okay, that could be a small things coming up in your office area through your colleague, through your bosses. Sometimes we call our bosses. I have a good boss, so I don't want to talk about my boss. But there are bosses that can be a pain. And we just say that, why am I going through this? Or even our government, as I've said, the Texas School Board, and so many things that's happening in our society today. Okay? And other things, it is happening. So the genuine, we as Christians, we are mocked. We are sometimes called as neglected, the way it's happening, the Islamization is coming here. We are just, if you talk about Christ, you will be persecuted. But if you talk about Islam as Islam and other religion, everybody's okay with that. That's what is happening here. And so you'll be mocked, you'll be cursed, and you will be just slandered, talked bad about. And to the extent, maybe you can get into prison. Maybe not here. Or you can be killed. Okay. So why does God allow us to go through this then? Because there's one basic reason, I believe, is to test, to try, and to prove that we are faithful to Him. He has called us. See, the Christian life, sometimes we look at it and we take it as, okay, I've accepted Christ and everything is smooth. I've got salvation. I know I have a place in heaven. That's smooth. It's not like that. Christ went through that. He was a model. So He came to this world and He had temptations. He had trials. He walked through until the end. And He's a model. So the disciple life, or the life that we go through as disciples when we become Christians, it's not going to be easy. Okay. We have to go through that. That doesn't mean that we don't have the hope. We have the hope of eternal life. But we are in this corrupted world that we have to go through this persecution and the things that we are going to face. And so that is part of disciplining. That's part of enduring. That's part of the life, the process that we have to go through until we physically go through at this earth and then move on to eternity. So when we suffer, what happens is, others get strength. That's what happened, right? And every persecution in the Word of God, if you look at Acts, if you look at even in the Old Testament, when there is persecution happening in the churches, the church grew. Because people will be praying. People will be strengthened. The rest of them will be strengthened. And there will be more churches built up. And that's what is happening in every part of the world. Other parts of the world, I'm not sure here. Okay, in my own, where I came from in Malaysia, they burned churches a few months back, because they were just upset with the word that we use in Malay, Allah, and in Arabic, Allah. They didn't like it. They said that you cannot use the word Allah because that is only for we as Muslims. And so, because we use our Bible in Malay, which has the word Allah. And what they did, they just went and burned churches. And the last time I went back, more churches are being built. More churches are growing more vibrantly because they meet in homes. And that's what's going to happen. When persecution comes, churches grow. And our faith becomes strong. And others will be drawn into Christ. Why? Because they see, why these guys who are going through this suffering, they are rejoicing. They are not being moved by what is happening. and they are strengthened. And so others will be drawn into Christ. So when we go through this, when others go through this persecution, we have to be known. I mean, we have to know that Christ has gone through this, and at times we may go through even today or in the coming years. But the attitude that we have is important. What kind of attitude that we have? We have to have the same attitude that what Christ had. That is to endure it and to be able to be prepared to go through this, because at the end there's victory. There's always joy that at the end there is victory. And that's the beauty of Christianity. We don't have like a hopeless people. No, we have hope. And our hope is in Jesus Christ, and He's going to do that. Secondly, rejoice in persecution. I think the verse talks about that in verse 13. But rejoice to the extent that you partake of Christ's suffering. How can you rejoice when you are persecuted? I find it, a very difficult thing to do, right? When you go through suffering, let's say you have sickness, or you're going through headache, you just put a simple one, and you go through headache, and he says, you can rejoice with that? Can you? You can't. But when this is what the Bible is telling us, rejoice in persecution, because why? Christ is with us. Okay, He went through that. He is going to be with us. He's just walking side by side with us. So when we go through this, the joy that is going to come is because He's sharing with us in the suffering. We are not alone. Sometimes that's the joy, that's the part that we miss, because when you accepted Christ, He is coming with you all along until the end. And so we tend to think that the rejoicing part is excluded because we think we are suffering alone. No. Christ is sharing with you in these sufferings. And sometimes we have to consciously look at it and think about it. If I go through something in my life, it could be sickness, it could be anything, it could be a job loss, or some other things that's happening. And it's painful, it's difficult. I'm not saying it's easy, but always be consciously remember that in this, I want to rejoice because Christ is with me. He's sharing with me. He's along, walking along with me. He's holding my right hand. He's not going to just abandon me in this suffering that I go through. So Christ, He's not rejecting you. Christ is not going to just throw you and say that, okay, you go through, I don't care. That's not our God. Our God is walking along with us. He's standing with us. And that's the beauty of our God. The God that we serve is a living God. And the Word of God is clearly given to us so that we can get encouragement and strength from that. So we have to identify with Him. If you want to have the joy in going through whatever that we are going through, joy doesn't mean that you just jump and say, okay, I'm having headache. I'm not talking about that. But the peace and the thing that is coming inside only can come if Christ walks with you, not in any other form. Okay, so I don't want you to misunderstand when I say rejoice in the persecution. It's not just shouting here and there, I'm happy because I'm going through suffering. That's not what I mean. But I think you all understand. It is the inner peace, the inner joy that God gives you. He only can give you that if you just walk with Him side by side. And He has assured us that He'll walk side by side with us. And it's a blessing. Because verse 14 say, blessed are you, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. Because it's for the glorification of God that when sometimes we go through that. So the thing that we go through, sometimes it's painful, sometimes it's hard. But just be assured that Christ is with us at all times. Okay? The people, when you look at some of these missionaries who have died, and their spouses or their children, when the missionaries go on a long journey, they send them. What hope they have? Nothing, right? They just send the father or the husband and wife, and they say, okay, y'all go. And the children stay back. Sometimes children are in other parts of the country or places. But what hope they have? Okay, it's only in Jesus Christ. So our hope is in Jesus Christ, nothing else. In this world, we will go through this. We will go through in one form or another. But we have to have this assurance that Christ is walking with us in all these things. Okay. And when we suffer, we get a reward. And that reward may not be here, but the reward may be in heaven. Matthew 5:12 says like this, blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. Okay, sometimes we don't see the reward. When we go through all these things, we say, why is it happening? Another question of why always is there for us, because we are in this world. We are part of this world. We go through all these things. But there is a great reward for us, you know. So when we suffer, when we go through this, there is a greater thing that is coming for us up there. The whole message that I want to give you all today is we have to be prepared. We have to be ready for these things that is coming into our society and our world here. The third thing I want to talk about is, which verse 15 says, but let none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, an evildoer, or as a busybody in other people's matter. Don't bring suffering on yourself by breaking the law or by doing evil things. Okay, I hope that's very clear. I mean, we are all believers, but don't break the law and don't do things that suffering just you take upon yourself. Okay, if you drive and the speed limit says is 70, and if you go 85 and you meet an accident because it's 15 miles above the limit, it's you bring upon yourself. Okay, so don't bring suffering and persecution on yourself by breaking the law, by doing things that is not Christ-like, that is not things that you should not be doing. Don't do it. Okay, and that is not suffering for Christ. So I want to distinguish that very clearly. One is, you suffer for Christ. If you are a believer, Christ will walk with you, and if that happens in your life, He is there to guide you through. The other part, if you take upon suffering yourself by doing things which is not right, which is wrong, then don't blame it on God. Okay, that is you taking upon yourself. And that's what he says, but let none of you suffer as a murderer. Like a murderer, he go and murder, and what he gets, there's a punishment for a murderer. Or a thief, you go and rob in somebody's place. If somebody takes a gun and shoots you, that's a punishment. You may just die like that. Okay, so don't do that way. And I think that's very clear for us as a warning. And sometimes we take that, or we don't need to take that. I hope we all are very clear that that's not what the Bible is teaching us. Okay, just taking upon suffering and persecution and say that, for the Christ's sake, I'm doing all these things. That's not what it is written here. Okay, so don't do that. There's one simple one there, I mean, easy one that sometimes we get into a trap is, as a busybody in other people's matter. I was just looking at it and I said, man, that is also so powerful. No believer is to interfere in other people's life as a busybody, not but strengthening and encouraging, I think it's fine. But when you get into other people's life as a busybody, okay, and it says that, and don't blame it of an I suffer because you go and backbite, you go and talk bad about some people, okay, and you go through suffering, don't blame it on God. Okay. And I thought that was so interesting, that even a small word like that, it's written in the Bible for us to be very careful on what is not only killing somebody or being a robber, but even talking bad about people or gossiping. Okay. So it's important that we understand that suffering comes in, and persecution and all that comes for the Christ's sake, for Christ's sake, or for the gospel's sake. Christ will be with us. God will be with us. But if you take upon yourself, don't put it and say that I suffer for Christ. That's not right. Okay? The last one I want to conclude and finish off here is, keep on, and this is the encouragement that I want to give to you all. Verse 17, for the time has come for judgment to begin at the house of God, and if it begins with us, what will be the end of those who do not obey the gospel of God? So I wanted to bring, this was my theme here from this 12 to 19, is suffering comes for Christians, for the house of God. We as Christians, we as believers, it comes. So I don't want you all to think that, okay, there is good things that is happening. No, there will be coming suffering. So with that in the center, as house of God, children of God, we go through this. And then what is the hope that we have? Look at verse 19. Let us therefore who suffer according to the will of God commit their souls to Him in doing good as to a faithful Creator. So keep on doing good and commit yourself to God. Okay? It's important that we commit ourselves to God. The world can mock you. The world can just hit you hard. The world can do anything upon you. But our role and our job is to commit ourselves to God And 100%, it's not just I commit 80% and 20%, it's no, 100%. And if we go through that suffering, then it's the will of God. That's what he says. Therefore, let those who suffer according to the will of God commit their souls. So if we go through suffering in the midst of all that, when we are right with God, then it's the will of God for us to go through that. Okay? And we can trust God because he's going to be there with us. God can be trusted. I think we all understand that. We all understand that. God can be trusted. And sometimes it's difficult, but we have to just cling on. He can be trusted. So the question is, are you committing yourself to God to be the anchor man or to be the person who's going to walk beside you? Are you committing your life to him so that we can endure all this walk that we are walking in this life? You know, he's a faithful God. He's faithful. It's only we who are faithless sometimes. We are unfaithful. He's always faithful. So what he's expecting out of us is our faith in him should be strengthened. That in the midst of what we go through in our lives, that we have to be strengthened, that he is faithful. He will not disappoint us. He will not let us down. Okay. So if we commit our souls to him, no matter what things happen in this world or anything that can happen, he will be there with us. And I think that's the assurance that I want to give you all. It's an endurance. It's a marathon race that we are all walking through. It's not a sprint that you run 100 meters. It's a marathon. It could be 46 miles. When you run 46 miles, it's slow. Okay, and you have ups and downs. And when you go ups and downs, he's walking with us. And that ups and downs can be very difficult for us, but he's there with us. He's going to be there with us. We, as a church, are going through some changes in our church setup itself. Yeah. And he's going to be with us. He's going to walk with us. He has been with us for the last 10 years, 9 plus years. Okay, and God is faithful. He's going to be doing the same thing or even better for us if we cling on to him and trust in him that he's moving us. He's doing great things for us as a church. Okay, do we have that faith that he's going to do great things for us as we go through this enduring process? Sometimes we say, man, 10 years I've been in this ACFI. Do we need to go along more? Yeah. Okay, as long as we live here. God has called you and me with a plan and a purpose to Austin. Nothing else. I've heard this very clearly many times, you know. If God wants to prosper us, make us wealthy, he don't need to bring you and me to Austin. Okay, he can do that for me in Malaysia, for us, for y'all in India, Singapore, wherever. He can make you wealthy. He can make you whatever you want to be. But why did he bring you and me here to Austin? Okay, particularly to this place. There is a plan and purpose. And we have to fulfill that purpose by enduring this battle, this war, this trials, this persecution that is coming upon us, and win this battle. This country needs us. Okay, this country needs missionaries like us to go and reach out to the people here. And that's a battle. That's a persecution. That's a trial. That's the thing that is going to come to us, you know. It's amazing that many, many years ago that this country sent missionaries out to India and other parts of the world, but this country today needs you and me. And so we are called to do that. Okay? Are we willing to suffer? Are we willing to take up this cross and go for him in this part of the world? Here in Austin. Austin needs us. And so as we as a church or body, we are going through this, and suffering comes, trials comes, difficulty comes, we have a lot of questions, but cling on, because it's a joy. He walks with us. Jesus Christ walks with us. You see, Peter, when he writes, he was concerned. He saw this church that is, he's moving away, he's getting old, and I want to make sure these people are strengthened. And it's very applicable today for us, you know, that we need to be strengthened. We need to hold on to our faith. God is faithful, and we need to hold on and hang on to him, because he is going to make us walk through this and go for a bigger thing for us in our lives. You know, they talk about iron. When things are formed, how iron is being put in the furnace and beaten and all that. I'm sure you all know the process, right? It just goes into a big furnace where iron ore or it just higher degrees, it's been burnt and taken out. With that heat, the iron man or the smith, will take an anvil or a hammer or whatever big things, and then he just mix it with that heat and forms something. Okay, and that comes all the iron items that we have, grills in house, or even things beautify, ornaments that we have in iron. But it's hot, right? Heat. And sometimes we have to realize that we may have to go through this heat in our lives, because when we go through all these things, in the end, we become a beautiful thing that can be rewarded, can be put for God to see. And maybe we are going through that. I don't know what you individually are going through. Okay? And we as a church have already talked about that. But individually you may be going through something. But I want you all to think and take it personally, that if you are going through something, suffering, it could be big, it could be small, but you know. And do you trust God that He's walking with you and He's going to lead you through? Do you have that confidence? Walking by faith is difficult. It's difficult. Because we just say, okay, I have to trust you. But our faith in God is the only hope that we have. Nothing else in this world. So our sovereign Lord is faithful, and He's expecting us to put our faith in Him. Okay? So I want to leave you all with that thought, that if you may be going through difficulty, trials, whatever that you may be going through, trust God. God is the only hope that we have. And this, I talked about persecution and all that, but I want to bring it down to personal. Okay? You may be going through difficulties in your life. I don't know what it is, but our hope is in God. Okay? He's not going to just let you down. He's faithful. Put our faith in Him. As a church, this church is going through a next phase, and our hope and our trust is in Him. And He will just make us go through and do the next thing that what He has for us. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You for this day. We thank You, Lord, that Your word is so clear to us. Lord, Peter was an apostle who was just a fisherman, and You have transformed his life. And what a testimony that he has brought to us as a disciple, as an apostle, and even as a writer in the book of 1 Peter and 2 Peter. What a great testimony that we have seen in the life of Peter. Lord, at his end of his life, he's strengthening the church at that time. But how applicable it is for us today, for this church, for our church here, Lord, that we need to be strengthened in our faith. We go through persecutions, we go through trials, we go through sufferings, but Lord, we need the strength that we can draw from You. We need to trust in You. And thank You for the hope that You've given to us, that You are giving us this joy of going through the persecution by sharing with us, by walking alongside with us. What a joy it is that You are walking alongside with us, Lord. And help us to have that confidence that You will not forsake us and You will not let us lose, but You will just come along with us. We thank You for that. And Father God, we thank You that we can put our faith and our trust in You. Even right now, Father, I pray for anyone who is going through sufferings, difficulties, trials, or even in their physical body, if they're going through ailment, Lord, I pray that You will just give them healing, and You just work in their lives today and help them to look up to You, because they can trust in You, our only living hope that we have. Father, we thank You once again for this day. We thank You for speaking to us through Thy word. And we pray, O Lord, that as we disperse from this place, that You will just send us forth with Thy blessing and help us to be prepared for the world that is out there, and help us to do Your will and to be Your servants and to serve You at all times. We pray and ask all these things in Jesus' most precious name. Amen.
Great is thy faithfulness. Please be the choir can come upstairs. Maybe they're teaching. Okay, we'll do the song without. This will be a song of offering. Great is thy faithfulness. O God, my Father, there is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not. Thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be.
Great is thy faithfulness. Thank you for that message. I just want to just add one thought because I find it helpful for me personally, and it's biblical. When we make a commitment, we should make a commitment to keep our commitment. That is easy. If you only can discipline your life, making commitment is okay. But if you commit to be faithful to the commitment, the Lord helps us a long way. I can give you personal testimony of that, but please keep that in mind. If you've said something, and God honors that. He doesn't expect us to do more than what we can, that we know. But at least what we say, we should be committed to it. And it starts with simple things, and God builds up from faith to faith to faith to faith to faith. And it's amazing how God will use you to be used in a way that you will be blessed. Can you say praise the Lord for that? Amen? Praise the Lord. So this is the last Sunday in this beautiful sanctuary. We are going to a better place in the sense that it's going to new challenges, as already mentioned. So So next Saturday, we are having the communion in the new place. And I want to encourage, we will still keep that half an hour prayer time before the service. Don't make a commitment if you're not willing to commit to the commitment. But 4:30, we can go there early. At the new place, can we go there early? Because I thought we are there from 5 to 7. Oh, 4 to 8. Then 4:30, we'll be meeting there every Sunday. Even today we had, and we are expecting great things from God. Thank God. Saturday. Oh, yeah. Every Saturday. That's right. Every Saturday. Praise God. Shall we pray? Father God, we thank you. We bless you. Father, we are so blessed just to know that we belong to you. Lord, we are blessed to be able to understand what the Word of God is all about. Because, Lord, there are so many people, Lord. The Word of God is there, but they cannot understand because they are blind. There has been no quickening of the Spirit. But, Father, we thank you that those of us, and we believe all of us, when we are quickened in the Spirit, Lord, we are sensitive to the voice of God. And, Lord, it is not difficult to hear your voice. It's the obedience part. And so, Father, even as we leave this place physically, we pray for the members of the board, the pastor, whoever is in this place. Lord, let this place be a blessing for many to come to know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. Because it doesn't matter in which building, it's the church. The church is the ecclesia, the called out one. This is only a facility. And so thank you, Father, as we go to the new place. And we pray for everyone here and also the place where we are going. Lord, united together, Lord, with the understanding that Jesus, you are with each one of us. You are with us wherever we are. Wherever Jesus Christ is lifted up, Lord, we will draw people unto you, Lord. Not only on the cross, but we keep on confessing that Jesus died on the cross. He was laid to rest in the tomb, but he arose again on the third day. He arose and ascended into heaven and sent the Holy Spirit to indwell us. We thank you. We give you all the praise. Father, we pray for those who are celebrating their birthdays, anniversaries. We commit them to you, Lord. We thank you for those who are not able to come or for whatever exigencies they have in place of work. We just commit each one of them. And Lord, we are excited about meeting next Saturday. And now, Father, we pray for this offering, whatever has been placed, Lord. We thank you that you will bless it and use it for the extension of your kingdom and especially to help those in need. And we give you all the praise for it, Lord. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father Almighty, and the sweet, sweet communion of the blessed Holy Spirit, who abides in us now and forever and ever, till Jesus come, we pray. Amen. Amen. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Praise the Lord. God bless you. Have a good week and see you next Saturday. God bless you. Any